Hi, my name is Brad.
And I'm Sunny.
And we are the Two-Faced Detectives. And today we're going to look at a video of a woman called Leigh Catherine.
Who is a phony.
Yes, she's claimed to be a psychic. And we are going to examine her facial expressions and body language to see if she is lying.
Which she is.
And she is on a show in the UK supporting a supposed psychic called Psychic Sally in defense of some allegations that have been against her. And we'll listen in to see what they have to say about it.
First of all, and this is the way it's been reported. A fan who was sitting in the back row of the Grand Canal Theatre in Dublin during one of Psychic Sally's shows told a radio station that she could hear a man's voice through an open window behind her, claiming that everything he said the psychic was saying 10 seconds later. She added that when theatre staff realised members of the audience could hear the mysterious voice during the performance, then the window was closed. But Stephen Fallon, the general manager of the theatre, said the voice came from two lighting technicians who were talking during the show. So absolutely not a clear-cut case one way or the other here. And then in a statement from her website, the recent performance at the theatre I felt was a fantastic show. I was completely unaware that two young lads who are employed by the theatre as technicians had been accused of feeding me information. I would like to state that I have never met these two boys before in my life. More importantly, they have nothing to do with my show. I have no communication with them. There is no way that they would have been able to talk to me whilst I was on stage. I receive hundreds of emails and letters from people who I have helped over the years, and their support inspires me to continue what I do. Which, of course, you know, we can't judge that one way or the other.
Okay, we're going to stop it right there, and we'll go back. But you kind of got the gist of what's going on here. This psychic Sally being accused of having people feed her information. And what we're going to concentrate on is this psychic Leigh Catherine, the blonde sitting there. She is going to defend psychics all over, saying that they are true. We're going to read her body language to see if she really believes that what she is saying. So, first thing, let's go back to this part right here. And take a look at this. First thing you want to notice is there the look of shock that's kind of on her face. And I'm going to go ahead and play the video, and you'll see that she notices that the camera is looking at her, and then she'll change her expression. So watch closely. She changes her expression
the
here.
Voice came from two lighting
all right, right there. Who were talking. She's like, she realized. Let's go back theater, said the voice and change. Came from two lighting you notice even her eye movements. Theater, she looks over at the camera came from two and then changes. Who were talking during all right, the show. So that's the first thing we noticed. Now we'll go ahead and we'll play some more and we'll see if you notice anything else. And then we'll let you know what we see in the video.
I was completely unaware that two young lads who are employed by the theatre as technicians have been accused of feeding me information from people who I have helped over the years, and their support inspires me to continue what I do. Which, of course, you know, we can't judge that one way or the other, but it certainly opens up the topic.
All right, let's jump back a little bit.
Which, of course...
And take note of their body posture. You look at him, he looks like he's pretty relaxed. If you notice, his legs are kind of spread open a little bit. And so indicating that he's somewhat comfortable. Even his arms, you can tell his arms look pretty comfortable as well. But you look over at her, it's a total different ballgame. Her legs are more closed, and she even has her hands covering her private parts a little bit, it looks like. And that really is an indication of feeling vulnerable or uncomfortable. And no doubt that's probably what she's feeling at this moment. So just continue to note their postures, and you'll be able to see the confidence levels of each one. So,
yeah, I'd definitely say you can see she's way more tense than he is. He's definitely more relaxed, but you know, it doesn't really take anybody with the real perception skills to notice that, really. But
of course, you know, we can't judge that one way or the other, but it certainly opens up the topic for conversation.
Judge it with something I found yesterday.
Okay, did you notice that?
For conversation.
See that right there?
With something I found,
she looks over at him.
Judge it,
she's got a very rigid posture still, but she's also breathing heavy. Look at her breathing.
It also looks like she has like a hint of fear on her face as well.
Judge it
with something I found.
Let me turn that volume down. All right, let's go ahead and play a little bit more.
Basically, she's not denying that she gets any communication from someone. She's denying specifically the lighting people.
Well, she says that it only her headset is purely a microphone. She does not receive. That's what she
says. Headset. Yeah. With the microphone is purely a microphone, and she can't get messages from that. But she has
this guy's done his research, really,
which is on the other side. And I'm not saying for legal reasons. I'm not saying she uses it every show, and I particularly think she won't be using it this week. But if you have a look at her biopic that's on the net, it's a link from her own website. Mm. It's called The Psychic Life of Sally Morgan, Part 5 on YouTube, 5 minutes 30 seconds in. There's a shot of her
exactly
on stage, taking off the microphone and a separate earpiece which she leaves dangling. It's an earpiece. Mm. She has worn an earpiece on stage.
Well, I haven't seen that, so we couldn't possibly comment.
Okay, that's my opinion, but I challenge her to deny that.
You say that there is no such thing as a sixth sense.
The sixth sense is a vague term because we all have intuition, which I think is based around making, you know, subconscious decisions about things. But I don't think anybody is telepathic, and I don't believe particularly that people can contact the dead, which is the major issue here. I have no real problem with people telling fortunes. Yeah, that's the kind of fun side of it, you know, and it's I don't think it's healthy. But the problem I have is when people pretend they can talk to dead people, particularly when they're doing it for profit.
And you say that you base this basically because
to dead people, particularly when they're doing it for...
See that?
She takes a gulp, it looks like, a little hard swallow. Looks like she's breathing kind of heavy, and it just seems like there's like a little bit of fear on her face and along with her neck area. Just kind of looks tense.
And look at how she looks over him with her eyes, but not with her head. She won't turn her head toward him, and it's kind of angled. I mean, that's just, you know, she doesn't want to face him, really.
Once upon a time, you learnt the tricks, as you call it, yourself.
Yeah, I've been a magician for 30-odd years. When I was a teenager, I learnt from a guy in Blackpool, my sort of mentor, about these techniques, which we'll probably talk about, cold reading, things like that. It's basically about judging people's body language, the way they're dressed, the way they react to things, and you basically fish around and tell them things that are quite generic but sound very specific. You know, when someone goes and sees a psychic or a fortune teller, they always do this line about, well, they couldn't have known that thing. I always advise them to record the session, because actually there'll be about 70 or 80 misses for every hit.
Okay, well, on the other side, Leigh, you say that you were born with this sixth sense, if that's what this sort of gift, I guess,
sense
of being able to contact the dead.
Absolutely. If Sally did it, I'd be very surprised, because Sally is usually on the money. I'm not
she
sure.
She certainly is on the money.
She certainly is on the money. Okay, I'll stop it right there. Go back one more time. And
absolutely. If Sally did it, I'd be very surprised, because Sally is usually on the money.
Okay, what do you notice there?
Absolutely. If Sally did it,
I know one thing I noticed, when she says Sally did it, there's a few hot spots anyway, I see. First one, she says absolutely, which is called a qualifier. Something to watch out for is like when somebody says truthfully or honestly, absolutely can kind of fall into those categories. So that's an indicator or a hot spot. Another one, she's shaking her head no when answering basically yes, which is called a disconnect. Because you think about it, if you were to answer yes to a truthful question, you wouldn't shake your head no. And vice versa, if you were saying no to a question, you wouldn't shake your head yes. So sometimes it happens, so you gotta consider the context and all that stuff, but most of the time, normally, we do not do that, so it's something to look at.
And notice what she does there, the shoulder shrug there, it's coming up right there. You know, very slight, but it, you know, this indicates that she's in disagreement with what she just said, you know? She's saying one thing, but she's not confident, or she is definitely disagreeing. Because when you shake your shoulders like that, you're saying, I don't know. When you shrug your shoulders, you shrug both shoulders normally, but when you're trying to hide it, it usually comes out asymmetrical. So it'll only come out on one side of the body. And That's what you see here, is the one side shoulder shrug. And she's basically saying that she is in disagreement with everything she is saying.
Absolutely.
It's seeping right
if
out of
Sally
her body.
Did it, it really I'd is. Be very surprised, because Sally is usually on the money. I'm not
she
sure
certainly
how,
is on the money.
How something can be generic
love
yet
comment.
Specific, because that's totally, the disparity there is, you know, very, very huge. However, there are, unfortunately, lots of charlatans acting as psychics and preying on people's vulnerability. And at the end
okay.
of the day, we're dealing
you see,
with...
That, we're going to stop there again. Look at this one more time.
Lots of charlatans acting as psychics...
What do you see her doing?
...and preying on people's vulnerability. And at the end of the day, we're dealing
okay,
with...
Okay, yeah, do you guys catch
here,
that?
And they should
I mean, look
be
at
accountable...
This.
To law if
do
they're
more
shoulder shrugs. Now what's the really context here? She's talking about psychics, she's saying they should be punished if they're charlatans, if they're frauds, you know, anybody that's doing this for the wrong reason should be punished. And obviously she disagrees with that, because the whole time she's saying that, she's shrugging her shoulder. Look at it one more time.
Lots of charlatans acting as psychics and preying on people's
One,
vulnerability.
Two, three,
and at the
four.
End of the day, we're dealing with people's lives here, and they should
Five,
be accountable
six,
to law.
Seven.
If they're conning people out of it, absolutely.
Obviously, there's going to be some charlatans out there. Of course, there is in any profession. Do you think if you took away the exchange of money, that would separate the people who were really doing it for the greater good and the people who were doing it
that's
for
a,
profit?
That's a good question.
Okay, and still, once again... let's see here. Sorry, I missed.
Separate the people.
Look at their posture again. Once again, I mean, you see the same posture. He's open, and she's protecting her genitals. You know, sort of like a dog. When a dog is frightened, they tuck their tails between their legs to cover their private parts. And that's what people do when they feel vulnerable. They'll cover their private parts.
People who were really doing it for the greater good and the
much like Adam and Eve.
That's a good question. Why, if it's a gift,
do you know what I mean?
And it helps people, why do they charge money for it?
If people didn't want to pay for services, they wouldn't pay for services. And I think to a degree, one is saying on Paul's defence that the public are very gullible and they're very vulnerable and they can be duped quite easily. So I think we're underestimating the public. I'm not saying that every member of the public...
Okay. Before I get to that, notice also what she's saying there. She's saying that her speech pattern is very slow, kind of broken up. She's thinking hard about what she's saying, and she's really just double talking here, because if you listen to what she has to say one more time.
One is saying on Paul's defense that the public are very gullible and they're very vulnerable and they can be duped quite easily.
Okay, so she's saying Paul is saying that the public's gullible and very easily duped. And listen to what she says to that.
So I think we're underestimating the public. I'm not.
So I think we're underestimating the public. So she's saying she disagrees with Paul, that the public is not gullible. Now listen to what she says right after that.
Not saying that every member of the public is not gullible or vulnerable, because they are.
So now she's saying that they are. Now which is it? Either they are or they aren't. This is what you call double talk. I mean, everybody knows double talk, but it's just funny how that's what she's doing the whole time. I'll play it back one more time.
One is saying on Paul's defense that the public are very gullible and they're very vulnerable, and they can be duped quite easily. So I think we're underestimating the public. I'm not saying that every member of the public is not gullible or vulnerable, because they are.
Well, let's talk about the way that, in that case, if you say that you can talk
she also wouldn't look at
you
it.
Don't do, you don't do the cold
time.
Calling, you don't do the fishing.
I don't even know what cold calling is.
Cold reading.
Cold reading.
Yeah.
And so do you fish? Do you fish for what you want people to have? Can I...
Okay, that was pretty interesting. Notice the reporter makes a mistake.
Cold reading.
Calling
reading.
It cold calling when it's really called a cold reading. But this actually might be the very only time she actually tells the truth during this. She says, I do not know what a cold calling is, and that's probably true because it's not what it's called. It's called a cold reading. So it's kind of funny.
She's actually being honest.
One is saying
separate the people.
One is
cold calling. Right, you don't do the fishing.
I don't even know what cold calling is.
Cold reading. Yeah. And so do you fish? Do you fish for what you want people? If I come to you. Because I always think that if you want to completely test the person that you're going to go and see,
mediumship is evidence, okay?
If you want to completely test the person that you're going to go and see, cold calling, you don't do the fishing.
I don't even know what.
I come to you and I say, there is someone that I desperately want to know from. I want to hear from this person, but I'm actually not going to say another word. Could you please contact them and tell me?
Yeah, mediumship is evidence, okay? It's evidence of survival after physically passing away. If you were 70 years of age and I said, oh, I've got your grandfather in spirit, hello, at 70 years of age, granddad's going to have gone to the other side and be in spirit.
What does that even mean?
Nobody knows what it means.
I mean, grandfather's already went to the other side of being spirit. What? What? I don't even know what that means.
It's funny because she said yeah to his question, but then she buries it in a bunch of Bologna.
Yeah, she does. And that's the... Well, watch that again.
Yeah, mediumship is evidence, okay?
Mediumship is evidence.
Yeah, mediumship.
See? Yeah. She's real quick to say yeah. And then suddenly she follows it up with a bunch of nonsense to bury that yeah, so that way she doesn't have to actually prove what she's saying. She just wants to get it out of the way. She agreed with it, so he can't say she didn't agree with it, but she's going to try to dominate the conversation here, so that way she doesn't have to prove her psychic abilities.
Is evidence, okay? It's evidence of survival after physically passing away. If you were 70 years of age and I said, oh, I've got your grandfather in spirit, hello, at 70 years of age, granddad's gonna have gone to the other side and be in spirit. Evidence is stuff like maybe how they passed, how they looked, characteristics, possibly months of anniversaries such as birthdays, their date of passing. I don't know how I could cold read a dead person because I'm not actually sure. Let me speak, please. What a cold reading, hot reading, as I've been hearing about all week. Because I'm not actually sure. Let me speak, please.
Let me see here.
I don't know how I could cold read a dead person.
Okay. Notice what she did there. That's what's called a straw man argument. She, you know, he wasn't making the argument she was cold reading a dead person. He was making the argument of a live person, but she's exaggerating the argument so that way she can deny it and therefore come off victorious or look like she is. It's a typical straw man argument.
Because I'm not actually sure. Let me speak, please.
And look at that. Once again, she didn't even look at him when he corrected her. She just, you know, she put her hand on him because she's controlling the conversation right now. She does not want anybody else to be able to have a word in edgewise, or otherwise they could steer the conversation back to reality. And she wants to steer away from anything that's going to make her prove that she's a psychic, because she knows where this is headed. Let's see here.
Because I'm not actually sure. Let me speak, please. What a cold reading or hot reading, as I've been hearing about all week, with this, in light of Sally's allegations.
Well, it's body language.
I don't know what it is, but I can't pick up
generalizations. Yeah.
Body language of a dead person. I can pick it.
Okay, did you catch a hot spot there?
Let's play it again.
Body
language of a dead person.
Okay, notice how she leans in, and usually this is interesting because usually when somebody leans in when they're trying to defend themselves or whatever, it's usually to look more convincing or to try to convince the other person. And a good example of this was Bill Clinton when he was talking about Monica Lewinsky. When he was lying about having sexual relations with her, he leans in, then he says, I did not have sexual relations with that woman. And that was the sound.
That's
more
pretty
convincing.
Good impression. I gotta say that's a pretty good impression.
<In practice.
laughs> I'm impressed.
But it's interesting because that's exactly what he did. Several other people do it too, so it's just kind of one of those things to look at.
Yeah, it's a classic there. And then she's also bringing in another straw man argument again, so if you listen in.
Language and generalizations, yeah.
Body language of a dead person.
Body language of a dead person. So we're talking about that.
No. The body language is of the living person.
See?
So you can see a twitch, you can read a twitch.
That's what I'm saying.
I don't really look for twitches because the way I work, but this is only the way I work because everybody works individually in whatever job they're in, is that I tend generally to kind of turn myself slightly this way as I'm.
Well, that's convenient.
So half the time I'm not even looking
at
my clients.
Under what circumstances can you do that reading? Is there a specific time and a specific environment that you have to be in to do your reading?
When I'm,
I don't think I noticed that before.
I mean,
was he steepling? Let's see if I can.
To do your reading.
When I'm.
Nope. Go back far enough.
The time I'm not even looking
under
at my clients.
Under what circumstances can
nope,
you
still didn't
do
go back far enough.
Where I work.
Oh, yeah, I guess it did.
I tend generally to kind of turn myself slightly this way as I'm concentrating. So half the time I'm not even looking
under
at my clients.
Under what circumstances can you do?
Oh yeah, yeah, right there. The magician guy, he's actually it's kind of like steepling. He's This shows kind of a sign of confidence. He's putting his fingers forward, his thumbs are showing. Just an interesting note there.
It's easy to show confidence when you're telling the truth.
Yeah.
Is there a specific time and a specific environment that you have to be in to do your reading?
When I'm booked, I mean, there needs to be peace and quiet.
Yeah.
And that
can you do
posture.
It for me now?
Not now, because I've come on here to debate stuff. I've not come on here to be a trick pony. I'm not saying I can't do it, but there's a room full of people.
Now, see, he leaned forward, if you notice, and that's because he's trying to compete for their attention. See, she's leaned forward, she's getting their attention. They're both in competition now to try to win the attention of the reporters or whatever you want to call them. And they are... Oh, I forgot my line of thought there. I was just playing.
And also, I also say to people, I don't read in public because I do to a degree, but I never know what's going to come out because we don't. Because everybody's lives, they're confidential and they have a right to confidentiality. I can give you examples of things that I've done in terms of bringing evidence that there is life after death. I have no, problem with that.
Where is the evidence?
But
okay.
Did you catch that hotspot?
Let's play it one more time.
Of things that I've done in terms of bringing evidence that there is life after death. I have no, problem with that.
Where is the evidence?
But there's evidence.
Where? What?
Let's see here.
But I can't
language
pick
and generalizations,
up
yeah.
Of okay. things that I've done in terms of bringing evidence that there is life after death. I have no, problem with that.
Where is the evidence?
But there's.
Okay, what do you see there, Sonny?
Well, again, she shakes her head no when she's talking about presenting the evidence and stuff and examples and really probably just indicating she has no real examples of this. So it's kind
of
interesting, another disconnect.
Things that I've done in
and she's
shrugging that
her shoulders again.
Death. I have no, problem with that.
Where is the evidence?
And I guess that's another thing we should
evidence.
Mention.
Where?
If you let me finish, please, I'll give
you one thing you want to do when you're looking for hotspots and determining whether somebody's lying or not is to not focus just on one hotspot, but it's called the cluster rule. You want to focus on several hotspots in one response. So that's just something to keep in mind. So you can't go by just one thing. So if she shrugs her shoulders, that doesn't necessarily mean she's lying. If she's shaking her head no and answering yes, that doesn't necessarily mean she's lying. So it's all about putting them into a cluster. And if there's several of them in one instance, then
there's no Pinocchio effect. There's no one clue that tells you, oh yeah, they're lying. The nose growing. It would be nice, but
pants catching on fire.
Unfortunately, it takes many clues to many hot spots to tell you this person is probably lying. And even then, you can't be 100% sure until you ask further questions and really delve into it. And then usually you can draw a person out and get them to admit it if they know that you're on to
being fed back to the medium a lot of the time. Can I just read you? This is from Sally Morgan's website. get to the venue early to take full advantage of the many ways that Sally can give you a message. You can complete one of Sally's love letter cards.
Okay, I want to go back just a bit here. Let me see.
It's not.
Okay, so therefore,
science is about proof.
Yes, and there is not.
I just want to ask you then. So we've heard how you do it. When you were doing this before, that you decided not to do it anymore, you were doing cold reading and fishing, and I just wonder whether you could give us a sort of example of how you do this and how easy it is.
Well, absolutely. I mean, the important thing that we haven't covered, which is what most of the stage psychics use, is actually pre-show work. It's not just the cold reading, that comes later.
The
pre-show work is basically people milling about in the foyer, listening to conversations of people as they're going into the theatre.
This is important.
There's plenty of people wandering around with handheld radio microphones in the theatre, listening to stuff, which is being fed back to the medium a lot of the time. Can I just read you, this is from Sally Morgan.
Okay, so this is very important. The stuff that he's mentioning there is very important, and we'll explain why in a minute. But he was saying that how psychics work is they basically have people before the show milling about in the lobby, listening into people's conversations, and they feed that information back to the psychic during the show. Now listen to what he has to say when he's reading from a website directly from Psychic Sally's website of telling people to get to the venue early. Listen to this. And pay attention to everything. I won't spell it out.
Website. Get to the venue early to take full advantage of the many ways that Sally can give you a message. You can complete one of Sally's love letter cards in the venue foyer and leave a question for Sally. You can leave a video message on Sally's special psychic cam, and you can bring a photo of a loved one past and Sally enable to connect with them in a spirit world.
Once again,
so all this
Okay, did you notice that? Let's look back at this.
Full advantage of the many ways that Sally can give you a message. You can complete...
Okay, he said get to the venue early. Did you notice what she did, though? Watch her face.
Full advantage of the many ways that Sally can give you... Full advantage of the many ways...
What is
that? Advantage of the many ways that Sally can give you a
message.
Full advantage of the many ways that
Sally can give you a message. What is that expression, Sonny?
Of the many ways that Sally
well,
can give you a
that is called a micro expression. And this micro expression in particular is looks like a mixture of fear and surprise. And how do you know it's fear? Well, if you look at her eyes, you notice that there's white showing above the iris, which is the colored part of your eye. Whenever there's a white above the iris, that's an indication of true fear. Also, you look at her mouth region, her mouth looks kind of tight and kind of looks like just a little bit of fear in it. But now where's the surprise come in? Well, to me it looks like the surprise comes in the eyebrows and also in the mouth region. The eyebrows go up. Usually in fear, the eyebrows, they'll go up, but they'll be kind of straight all the way across, basically. With the surprise look, it's just they're kind of more rounded when they go up. The mouth portion, you notice how the jaw drops a little bit. So in surprise, usually your mouth drops open sometimes, depending on who you are.
But she's keeping her mouth shut that whole time, so
she's showing it looks like a little bit of maybe both surprise
right.
and fear.
Her jaw's dropping like in
yeah.
surprise, but her mouth is tense like in fear.
Mm-hmm. And the interesting thing about micro expressions to keep in mind is they don't tell you whether somebody's lying or not, but they do give you insight onto how the person's feeling. So, interesting.
That's right. And so what we're asking here is, what is the context of what's going on here? Why is she showing fear and surprise? Well, he's reading from Psychic Sally's website that's telling all the people to get to the venue early so we can eavesdrop on you, basically. And she's like, oh, crap, this is my tactic. This is, you know, this is how we work. And he just said that's how we work, and now he's proving it by reading from her website her instructions to her customers.
So this micro-expression alone should tell you, hey, there's something fishy.
Yeah, this is all I need to convince me that this woman is a fraud. I mean, you would not show this expression for any other reason than, you know, being a fraud.
full advantage.
I love this one.
You can complete one of Sally's love letter cards in the venue foyer and leave a question for Sally. You can leave a video message on Sally's special psychic cam, and you can bring a photo of a loved one past and Sally enabled to connect with them in a spirit world.
Once again,
so all this stuff has been handed in.
Once again, we don't know how. But we don't know
yes,
how
we
she's
do.
Interpreting that. We don't know how she's using it.
Yes, we do.
I do. She says that, but you say you can use a
he's confident
handful
about it.
Of questions to get a response.
Sure.
So would you do that?
Okay.
Do that now.
Let's do that.
We will come back to you, by the way.
Don't worry. Right.
She looked worried.
And it's basically
holding her crotch.
Let's just do it. Five quick things. Directed at person one who's viewing this. You make friends very, very easily, but you've actually got very few close friends. And part of the reason for that is because you tend to bottle things up and you should let things go. And fairly recently, you feel you were betrayed by a friend. It's actually partly your own fault, but you still feel that you're betrayed by a close friend. Secondly, there's an older man that you associate with the initial B, an older man who's probably in your family or close to your family, and he's always suffered long-term with a pain at the sort of back of his chest region.
Okay, did you notice that? Let's watch that one more time.
Long-term with a pain at the...
What was that?
Long.
See, she's smiling. As he's talking, he's telling the tactics, or he's performing. He's performing as a psychic. And she knows exactly what he's doing and how he's doing it. And she's smiling because she thinks, probably thinks, well, yeah, he's really good at this. And this is probably how I would do it too, or how I do it. But then she notices, once again, she's very aware of when the camera's watching her. And she does this.
With a pain.
Oh, changes the expression.
Oh,
I can't let anybody find out that.
At the sort of back of his chest region, okay? But when you think of him, you always think of that daft thing that he does that makes you laugh. Thirdly, you're generally outgoing. You make friends easily. That would apply to number one as well. You are sociable, but just occasionally you feel really detached and insecure about yourself. It's almost as though you're kind of zooming out and watching.
Once again. Cameras, you know.
Secure about yourself.
This time the cameras, you know, she's like, well, the camera wasn't looking at me, and she started smiling again. And now the camera's looking at her again. She notices it, but she can't really. She wants to be more subtle this time. She's not trying to just wipe the smile off her face every time. So she slowly removes the smile. And watch the action here. I'll slow it down, or I'll play it. In succession. See how it slowly goes down?
It's almost as though you're kind of zooming out and watching yourself from a camera from above, something like that. Number four, you've got a scar. It's only a small scar, and it's not from an operation. It was from an accident you had years ago, and it's on your left leg in the middle. Number five, you have a recurring dream, final one, recurring dream. Where you're falling, right? Not falling.
That's an interesting pose there too. What would you say about that?
Me?
Yeah.
Well, I would say she's showing confidence because she knows that what he's talking about is like her. Like she's like, that's me. But I think more importantly, what the heck is he doing? Look at his face.
That is true. He's kind of looking at the other guy. I don't know. Is he looking? Okay, is he looking at the girl?
I don't know. I'm concerned.
Looking at
he's looking at the guy's palm. Look at him. He's looking at his palm.
Yeah, that's what it is.
He's like, ooh, that's a nice palm.
He could be looking at the guy. I don't know.
I'm concerned.
It's hard to tell from this angle.
I'm creeped out.
Flying down an escalator or some stairs. Right. This alternates. You only have it very sporadically with a dream about being held underwater. You're struggling to catch your breath. Okay.
Well, it's kind of me, basically.
All the way through, she's going, that's me.
That's totally, the letter B, my dad's Brian. I have got a scar on my left leg in the middle. All of those things,
Think about your father for a second.
Just... Like, I'm on TV, so everybody thinks, oh, you're all chatting, this and the other. But, you know, when I get home, I'm really quite quiet.
Why am I getting a picture of your dad in a kind of greenhouse or a conservatory? Did he used to do a joke about something to do with... People in glass houses shouldn't throw stones, something like that.
So what you...
Okay, my dad does work for double glazing. That's really freaking
so
me
what
out.
Look,
I know that
I think it's funny right here
that
even the psychic there, she is, like, really duping in all this. He's like, this is...
Throw stones.
She's entertained by this, genuinely.
My dad does work for double glazing.
Oh, come on.
Really freaky, man.
You see right there? She is enjoying herself because he did such a good job reading her. And she's really, it's just, she knows that this is how she works, and she's impressed with the magician as well.
You can think about your mum, because I won't say here, but there's a small plane going past
there. And she likes
the
fact that the girl's entertained by it.
And I'm getting a picture of when you were a teenager, there's something to do with a parrot repeating something about, it's Pretty Polly, something like that, but then the parrot turns into an aeroplane and you're shouting mummy. As a kid, you're pointing out the window and shouting mummy at the plane. Does that mean anything?
I don't know. Well, Pretty Polly might have been... But then I don't... I mean, you're doing this because you know it's fake. I mean, none of this is real. You're just making this up, aren't you? But cold reading.
This has all been a scam to launch my career as a genuine psychic.
I think it's very important that we get another side to the argument here. Leigh, you have listened to all of that.
I'm booking him myself for a reading later.
What do you say? What do you say to
sarcasm.
All of that?
It's
pretty compelling really.
Stuff.
It is compelling, and it's also... You know, these people that are acting as charlatans, I mean, it's the first I've heard about people, I'm sure they do it, I'm not denying that they do it, stage psychics, as they're called, that send people as spies into the foyer and stuff like that. If I do a show, I can't afford to pay people to do that and get all the tacky thing and ask for...
Okay, wait a minute, let's back us up.
Catch the hot spot.
Okay, let's play this one more time.
It's the first I've heard about people, I'm sure they do it.
Okay, what did she say there? Let's play it one more time.
It's the first I've heard about people.
What is she doing there?
Well, I would say she's shaking her head no while saying yes. She's saying it's the first I heard of it, but she's not. It's not really.
It's the first I've heard about people.
Yeah.
I'm sure they do it. I'm not denying that they do it. Stage psychics, as they're called.
And the other thing is, too, she never really was called out. Nobody asked her if she had been, had heard of this before. But she's like, well, this is the first I've heard of it. So she's on the defense. Mm-hmm. She's already defending herself. And so she's got a guilty conscience.
She also did a... something else.
It's the first I've heard about people. I'm sure they do it. I'm not denying that they do it. Stage psychics, as they're called, that send people as spies into the foyer and stuff like that. If I do a show, I can't afford to pay people to do that and get all the tech.
You guys catch that?
Let's play that one more time.
For that. But that's just me.
That was pretty obvious.
Yeah.
Big shoulder shrug.
Big.
For that. But that's just me. I
really?
For that.
But she did it too when she said, I can't afford to pay people to do that.
Oh, yeah, that's right. She did, didn't she? So
something tells me maybe she can't afford to pay people to do that.
It's very slight that time, but
tacky thing
and then it gets big
photos and messages. I don't ask for that. But that's just me. I don't know how other people work. But the thing is, what I will say, I've uncovered a con artist who was posing as a psychic some years ago.
Oh, please believe me.
And I approached Trading Standards to help out, and they basically refused. So if
on
there
what
are
grounds?
Because I was another psychic, and they couldn't take my word for it. So my answer was,
should
if
I
a
do
doctor,
it, then?
Yeah, I think so. So I said, if a doctor reported another doctor for medical negligence to the GMC, would they not take their word for it? So to a degree, people are saying there
He's
are laws
leaning
to protect
in to compete
the public,
with.
But then they don't go and act
on
it.
Can I suggest something, just very quickly? Something we haven't covered. There is a prize offered of $1 million in the States, and it's worldwide, if anybody can prove they have any psychic ability of any kind. It's been open since 1964. It started as $1,000. For years, it's been $1 million. They've had hundreds of applicants, and it's scientifically tested. Whatever.
And play that again?
Yeah. See if they catch it.
All right.
Dollars. They've had hundreds of applicants, and it's scientifically tested. Whatever the person claims they can do, dollars. They've had hundreds
for that, but that's just me.
Dollars. They've had hundreds. dollars. They've had hundreds of dollars.
Shit, that
they've
is... had hundreds of applicants. Hear that deep breath she's taking? Hundreds of applicants. You can even hear it.
Yeah, I know.
Usually when somebody takes a deep breath like that, I mean, it's an indication that they're feeling very uncomfortable. It even sounds like she's trying to maybe distract, get some attention off him, maybe. I don't know. Kind of interesting.
Dollars. They've had hundreds of applicants, and it's scientifically tested. Whatever the person claims they can do, they design a test around that
Would
claim.
Would you ever go at that? Million dollars?
If someone is psychic, why has that not been claimed since 1964? $1 million donated to charity. Maybe give it to a charity that deals with cancer. If someone is psychic, why has that not been claimed? Dollars. They've had hundreds of If someone is psychic, why has that not been claimed since 1964? $1 million.
Okay. Let's play that one more time. See if you notice what she does here.
If
see that? She did a she swallowed hard. Let me play it one more time. Gulp. And she looks over at him real quick and looks back, and you can tell there's just the tenseness of fear on her face and her body, her whole posture. Everything about her is saying she's very uncomfortable and she's afraid of what he's saying right now. He's talking about trying to claim a $1 million prize from James Randi. She knows if she tried out for that prize, she would fail. And so she's hoping they don't call her out on it, but she knows they are. So she's going to be facetious about it and just make light of it.
If someone is psychic, why has that not been claimed since 1964? $1 million donated to charity. Maybe give it to a charity that deals with counselling the bereaved.
Last word.
Well, after my reading with Paul, I'm going to get him to give me a lift to Heathrow.
Do you think you can have the $1 million?
Oh, absolutely. Well, and I'll give half of it to Paul if I win it, eh?
Did you catch any other hot spots there? Let's watch it again.
Okay.
Notice the different changes that take place.
Last word.
Well, after my reading with Paul, I'm going to get him to give me a lift to Heathrow.
Do you think you could have the $1 million?
I'm sure everybody sees what's going on there.
Yeah.
Play it one more time. Turn down the volume a little bit.
Last word.
Well, after my reading with Paul, I'm going to get him to give me a lift to.
What do you see there?
Well, there's a couple of things I noticed. One. She moved what we call anchor points, which anchor points can be, or your legs always count as anchor points, your arms can count as them, and so on.
So let's point these out. First of all, let's go back one to what her posture looked like before, and where are her anchor points?
Right now they're planted on the floor.
Both these neat legs are planted straight down. Okay.
Good drawing.
Yeah, I think that's horrible. And let's see. Now we'll skip ahead to the next.
Last word.
What?
And now look where they're at. She's got one leg crossed over the other. And not just that, but do you notice how violently that leg is shaking?
Oh, yeah. Very, very violent.
I imagine just placing a football right there. I imagine she'd kick it across that ship that's out there. Whatever that thing is.
I don't know. What is that in the background?
I don't know.
Yeah, look at that. Boom, Paul, boom,
I'm going to get him to give me a lift to Heathrow.
She could kick a field goal.
It's good.
Can we do that and come back and talk about it?
We'll send a crew with you.
Look how sarcastic your smile
lovely,
is.
Lovely, I love the States.
Cool. Oh, very. Okay. Lovely, I love the States. The she's shaking her head no the whole time she's saying it.
Well, after my reading, lift to Heathrow.
Do you think you could have the $1 million?
Lift to Heathrow.
Do you think you can have the $1 million?
Oh, absolutely. Well, I'll give half of it to Paul if I win it, eh?
Can we do that and come back and talk about it?
We'll send
some
crew
anger
with you.
Too.
Yeah, really.
Lovely. I love the States. Cool.
Terrific. Okay.
$1 million. Sugarhead Noah, she said, I love the States.
Educational Foundation, if anybody wants to apply for that.
So, thank you both very much indeed.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
All right, well.
Looks like she has some relief on her face.
Yeah, I mean, it's over.
Thank God this is over.
Okay, that was our video analysis of Leigh Catherine, and please like and subscribe to our channel if you like what we had to say.
Also, feel free to comment, maybe point out something that you've seen that we may have missed, And also, feel free to check out our Facebook page, Two Face Detectives, where you can get to know us a little better. Also, you can pick up some interesting tips
and techniques. We post tips from all over, and you can also suggest a video that you would want us to analyze, or even send us a video of your own. But remember, the stakes must be high in order to detect lies. So
subscribe.
All right.